Rival camps claiming to be the legitimate operators of Okada Manila trade accusations anew. That's after the camp of Japanese tycoon Kazuo Okada held a press conference where it released a video showing allegedly peaceful discussions to take over the resort casino. This supposedly contradicts Tiger Resort Asia's claims of a violent takeover that happened on May 31. Kazuo's camp also asserted Okada Manila is still operating normally and that revenues have returned to pre-pandemic levels. In a statement, the Hong Kong-based Tiger Resorts Asia denounced the Kazuo camp's statements, accusing the group of credit grabbing. That's as it insisted the high revenues of the hotel is due to its own efforts. And it also maintained it owns 99.99% of Tiger Resorts Leisure and Entertainment's shares, which operates Okada Manila. Joining us now is Norman Goles, the spokesperson of Okada Manila. Good morning, Attorney Goles. Thank you for joining us. Attorney Goles, I think you're still on mute. If you could kindly unmute.
Hi, good morning, Mike and Nikki.
All right, Attorney Goles, let's begin with what happened on May 31. Was there a violent takeover of Okada Manila?
No, there was no. There was no violent takeover on May 31. Rather, there was a violent defiance of the Supreme Court order. Now, if I may be allowed, as early as April 27, the Supreme Court had already issued a status quo ante order. And what did the status quo ante order say? In essence, the Supreme Court said that the Tokuda management or Tokuda board was being ordered to maintain the status quo prevailing prior to Mr. Okada's removal as stockholder, director, chairman, and COO of TRLEI in 2017. In addition to that, the Supreme Court said the status quo ante order is effective immediately and continuing until further orders from the Supreme Court. Okay, so as early as April 29, or 2 days after the issuance of the status quo ante order, the same was already served on the respondents, you know, Tiger Resort Leisure and Entertainment Inc. Through councils, were served with a copy of the status quo ante order. What is very bothersome is that we heard in many interviews of the other camp that they were never served with a copy, and that during the implementation they had demanded that they be served with a copy of the Supreme Court order. That is downright false. As you very well know, Mike, you being a lawyer. Notice to counsel is actually notice to the principal, right? And during the time on April 29, when a copy of the status quo order was served on the respondents, it was still through its former counsel, Mayor, and Mayor Law Offices. It was not yet Divina Law at the time. And again, interestingly, Mayor Law Office had already filed a motion for reconsideration of the issuance of the status quo ante order at the time that the same was implemented. So without a doubt, the respondents knew of the issuance by the Supreme Court of the status quo ante order, and they had no choice but just to comply. They could not do anything at that point because you cannot take the law into your own hands, Panyero. You know that. There have been a lot of misleading allegations that have been made in many interviews. And the Okada group chose to keep mum at the time because we were so focused on trying to get back, trying to normalize the operations. And thank God, as we speak, everything is now back to normal. We have good numbers. Occupancy rate is really high. Food and beverage revenues are also quite high. So that's why we were constrained to hold a press conference the other day to finally speak up and clarify these matters.
Attorney Goles, there was an allegation from the other side that you, at least your camp, the camp of Kazuo Okada, did try to secure an order from a lower court to be able to secure the premises of Okada Manila or take over the premises of the Okada Manila. And they're saying that that motion was not acted upon. And so they were surprised when about 50 security personnel and police officers stormed Okada Manila for the takeover. Was that necessarily the case? Didn't you wait for an order from the lower court before taking over Okada Manila?
Yeah, so there were, just to clarify this issue, there were actually two attempts to implement a status quo ante order of the Supreme Court. The first one was on May 2. Okay, on May 2, the Parañaque sheriff, Parañaque RTC sheriff, attempted to implement the status quo ante order. Unfortunately, the Tokuda group refused to abide by the Supreme Court's order. And so we were constrained to file several motions in court. Okay, but on May 31, the sheriff, together with PNP personnel, together with the PAGCOR representative, as well as together with the new board, meaning the Okada board, went again to the Okada Manila premises, and we were able to successfully implement peacefully. We have several videos of the entire thing. It was very well documented. We showed this during our press conference last Monday. Regretfully, we deem it not yet the opportune time to furnish the media with a copy, although we can show it. The videos would show that the sheriff of Parañaque RTC, as well as the PNP personnel and the PAGCOR representative, peacefully, they were allowed to go inside the premises. They entered without any issue. There was no violence at all. So from the entrance, they went straight to the Okada corporate offices, okay, where they met with Mr. Tokuda and some of the members of the previous board. Mm-hmm. During such meeting, the counsels for the Okada group, together with the sheriff, together with the PNP, together with the PAGCOR representative, explained to Mr. Tokuda that if they want to question the Supreme Court order, they should just file the appropriate motion in court.
Attorney Goles, I'm sorry to cut you off, but we don't really have much time though. But I want to ask you, what about this video that we're actually showing coming from the TRLEI camp, showing a bit of a commotion? It came from Attorney Star Lamparo, who said that the lights in the ballroom were turned off while they were conducting a stockholders meeting. Dozens of guards forcibly forced them out of the ballroom. So that's the violence that they're referring to. And yet you're saying this is a peaceful takeover.
Yes, correct. Because, you know, Mike, when the PNP personnel, and when the sheriff met with Mr. Tokuda, Mr. Tokuda relinquished the leadership, relinquished the offices. He even surrendered his ID. When he left the corporate offices, it was then when the new board of directors, together with Mr. Okuda, who joined them via online, as well as met with the senior managers of the company of Okada Manila, and by the time that Attorney Ilamparo arrived, members of their legal team arrived, the implementation was already complete. There was already a turnover, and so now, being the duly constituted board, of course, the duly constituted board had all the right to protect itself from disruption. So when Attorney Ilamparo arrived, her clients were no longer inside the corporate offices. She attempted to disrupt the meeting being held by the board of directors. Now, by the time that the incident that was being shown in the grand ballroom, that's actually the alleged impromptu stockholders was held in unreserved was being illegally held. Why is it illegal? Because for one, that's not really a stockholders meeting. You cannot just have an impromptu stockholders meeting. You have, you know, under the corporation code, you have to comply with certain legal requirements. And without doing so, that's just an ordinary meeting among friends. Number two, they had no reservation to use that room. They were given several hours to peacefully vacate that room, but they did not want. Now, again, I would like to invoke Article 429 of the Civil Code, the doctrine of self-help. Us lawyers know that very well. Without a court order, a lawful possessor and owner of a thing is the right to prevent any unlawful aggression, and it's the right to prevent anyone from usurping your rights. So that is exactly what happened there.
So you're saying, Attorney Goles, that it was actually the TRLEI group, the Tokoda group, who was actually the aggressor in this particular case. They were the ones causing disruption to Okada Manila. But what about Mr. Hajime Tokuda? He was supposedly kidnapped and illegally detained. That's among the complaints filed before the Department of Justice. Attorney Ilamparo told us that he was taken out of the room, brought to a car, taken around before he was brought home. So what happened to him?
Let me just say this. There are already ongoing cases before the DOJ, and one of which is that the alleged kidnapping case, okay, the kidnapping case. And we have yet to file our counter affidavit. And so I don't want to get into the details of our defense, but this is what I want to tell everyone at this point. I have seen the evidence. You will see when we file our counter affidavit that Mr. Tokuda was not forced to get into a vehicle. He was not kidnapped. Hindi siya inikot-ikot. That is utterly false. That is very, very irresponsible to allege, really. And we will just wait for our turn, since it's already with the proper authorities. We will file our counter affidavit, and once we've filed it, then we can shed more light into it.
Let's talk about the basis for Mr. Katsuo Okada to take over Okada Manila. The other group is saying that he was only holding a nominal share, one share in TRLEI, and that was actually withdrawn by TR Asia Limited, supposedly because of anomalies involving a $17.3 million loan. What is your position on this? Are you saying that that removal was illegal and that he can rightfully return to his post?
Well, first of all, the anomalies are false. They are not true. Mm-hmm. TRLEI is not just owned by TRA. Okay. It goes all the way up to, if you do a grandfathering of the shares, it will reveal that Okada Holdings Limited owns more than 70% of Okada Manila. Okay. Mm-hmm. Okada Holdings Limited is in turn owned by, okay, so around 46% or 47% shares in Okada Holdings Limited is owned in the name of Mr. Katsuo Okada. Mm-hmm. His son, Tomohiro, owns in his name around 43% of the shares in OHL. Okay. Mm-hmm. Now, the remaining 9%, about 9%, is owned by the daughter. Hiromi. Okay. Mm-hmm. So, even assuming for the sake of argument that TRAL does not recognize that Mr. Okada is its sole representative, still the 46% shareholdings registered in the name of Mr. Okada would give him about 36-37% in Okada Manila. So the one share, it's not an issue to us. But again, we are confusing the public. We are confusing the authorities. There is a status quo ante order. And what did the Supreme Court say? The Supreme Court said that to respect the status quo prior to 2017, And what was the status quo? The status quo then was that Mr. Okada was the sole representative of Tiger Resort Asia Limited.
Hmm. How would you address the stand of Attorney Lamparo that Tiger Resorts Asia Limited was not a party to that Supreme Court case and could not be bound by the status quo ante order?
Oh my God, that is the most ridiculous thing I've ever heard. If you look at the petition itself, the petition for review and certiorari filed before the Supreme Court, you will see in the caption, Mike. You know, how I wish you would allow me to share screen, but I have so many pieces of documents to share. But I've seen it in the petition itself. Trial was made a party. Mm-hmm. The Supreme Court's order, status quo ante order, it even copy furnished trial also with that order. So it is absolutely false. The trial is not a party.
All right. Now, Attorney Goles, if the status quo was to restore the situation prior to June 2017, what's the involvement of Mr. Tony Boy Cuanco? Because I understand from the documents that I've seen, he became a stockholder and director after June 2017. So why was he part of the team that took over Okada Manila if the status was to be restored prior to June 2017?
Yeah, you know, prior to 2017, there were only 8 members of the board of directors. Mm-hmm. And yes, you're right. Prior to 2017, Mr. Cuanco was not yet part of the board. But in the interim, from 2017 up to the present, several members of the board had already passed away. Hence, sometime on, I think it was around May, sometime in May, prior to the implementation of the status quo ante order, a board meeting, a special stockholders meeting was held, wherein the vacancies were filled up. This is fully documented as well, Mike. We would probably be able to show that again another time.
But if he wasn't part of the board prior to June 2017, what would be his interest in implementing the status quo ante order?
Well, because Mr. Okada is the sole representative of TRAL, okay, and that was the status quo prior to his removal in 2017, then he may also assign nominal shares to people to fill up the seats in the board of the board of Okada Manila, and that's exactly what happened.
Mm-hmm. So his one single share, because he was holding one nominal share, right? So he could assign it to Mr. Cuanco? Is that what happened here?
No, apart from the one nominal share that he owned, he, as I've said earlier, he had full control of the 99.9% shares of TRAL.
So he could assign a share from that. All right, yes, sir, what steps are we looking at now from this point? You have a pending petition before the Supreme Court, right? So what are we expecting in the coming days?
Well, the battle isn't over yet. This is just the start. Mr. Okada had waited for a long time to come to this point. It was 2017. It's already 2022. Mm-hmm. We will respect the processes. We will respect the orders of the Supreme Court, and we expect the other camp to also respect the processes and the order of the Supreme Court. So while the main case is being heard, in the meantime, Mr. Okada will go back or has resumed its rightful place in the board of directors. He is, as I stated earlier, as per the status quo ante order, we go back to the status quo prior to his removal in 2017.
Mm-hmm. Are there still pending matters with respect to the mother company, Tiger Resorts Holdings, if I'm not mistaken, the battle for control between Mr. Okada and his offsprings?
We understand that there are still ongoing cases. We don't know exactly what the status is of those cases, but we are confident that eventually the courts will declare Mr. Okada to be the true legal and beneficial owner of 100% of the shares of Okada Holdings Limited. Interestingly, Mike, I'd just like to mention, at the time that Okada Holdings Limited was established, or rather Universal Entertainment Corporation was established, Mr. Tomohiro was only age 31? Mm-hmm. And his father was already what, like 55, 56 years old? How do you expect a 30-year-old to be able to afford to invest millions, if not billions of dollars in establishing the business? Unfortunately, Mr. Okada was betrayed by his own son, and we're now where we are.
Lastly, Attorney Goles, what assurance can you give patrons or customers of Okada Manila that the operations will go on smoothly, and that your personnel will not be laid off, they will still have jobs? And also, you've been accused of credit grabbing by the other group.
You know what? The Okada Group does not concern itself with taking any credit whatsoever. The primary purpose of stating the status of Okada Manila last Monday when we had the press conference is just to assure the public that it is business as usual and there is no disruption in the business despite the controversy surrounding the management. Yes, business is doing better since the Okada Group resumed office. If the Tokuda Group is so concerned with being given the credit, then by all means, take it. They can have the credit. Our concern here is the public. Our concern here is the welfare of the employees. So far, so good. The employees' salaries are being paid timely. We're able to fulfill our obligations to our vendors. There are no grievances filed. And so it's also another false news from the other camp. Walang nagre-reklamong mga empleyado because bayad ang sweldo nila.
All right, on that note, thank you so much for sharing your side with us, Attorney Norman Goles, spokesperson of the Katsuo Okada Group.